Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for being with us. We know it's early on Thursday morning, the final day of our conference, so we're so glad that you're here with us for this panel, which I'm so excited to introduce. The title is From Human Cannonballs to County Fairs to Lindsay Lohan and Olivia de Havilland, Hot Issues of Rights of Publicity Law. With us today, we are lucky to have this amazing panel. We have as our moderator Dale Cohen. He's an experienced media attorney. He is currently special counsel with PBS's award-winning documentary series Frontline, and he's professor of UCLA School of Law. Next to him is Kelly Sager, our own Kelly Sager, who was formerly chair of this conference. She is clearly one of the nation's most prominent media attorneys with Davis, Wright, and Tremaine. Next to her is our own Ben Scheffner, an appellate lawyer representative. And Ben is a senior vice president and associate general counsel for the Motion Picture Association of America. Next to him is Bly Faust, who we are honored to have with us. She's not only an attorney, but she is also an Oscar-winning movie producer of Spotlight. And finally, on the end, not at all least in this group, is Duncan Crabtree Ireland, who is the COO and general counsel of SAG-AFTRA. Thank you. For questions, if you have questions, would you mind writing notes, and we'll have somebody go around and collect them before the end. Thank you.
So, good morning. Thanks for joining us. I apologize in advance for those of you who came thinking you were going to see either Lindsay Lohan or Ms. We weren't able to secure either one of them for the panel, but as Autumn said, I think we have a really great panel and a very interesting discussion ahead on a very confusing and complicated area of the law. And so I'm going to call upon Kelly to sort of set the context, talk about where we are today, and then we'll go from there.
Okay, thanks, Dale, and thank you all for having us here today. It really is a privilege and an honor to be here in this group. So what is right of publicity? And let's see if I can make this thing work. Nope.
Green.
I'm pressing the, oh, got it, okay. So for those of you who may not have either handled or been involved in one of these cases, or for those in the audience who aren't lawyers or judges, what the right of publicity protects is the unauthorized use of someone's persona for commercial purposes. What that means has really broadened over the years. It used to be the name or likeness of a person couldn't be used as the law started to develop for commercial purposes. To put someone's face on an advertisement for a car, for example, or a flour sack, as one of the early cases involved. It's broadened to include other things that are aspects of someone's personality, like their voice, like their signature. Some will argue even things broader than that, like statistics that may, when all put together, talk about somebody's football career or basketball career. But it involves commercial uses, which is also important when we're talking about how the law has developed. Because it used to be, after the turn of the century, when states started adopting or recognizing right of publicity as a claim that plaintiffs could bring, and this is the state law claim, when this started developing, it used to be fairly easy to divide the cases into two camps. One was cases that evolved because someone had been used in a commercial product advertisement. As I mentioned, putting a young woman's face on a flour sack where the law had not yet developed was not found to be actionable, but as right of publicity became recognized, that kind of use was a violation of her rights. Putting somebody in a car advertisement who hasn't authorized that use. On the other side were cases involving what we consider to be traditional First Amendment protected expressive works. You can't stop somebody from putting an article about you in the newspaper, for example, on the argument that they make money, at least theoretically, that they make money. And so those kinds of things are still protected by the First Amendment. And the cases involving those kinds of uses, books, movies, newspaper articles, magazine articles, the plaintiff's cases would be barred by the First Amendment. But in the only case that the U.S. Supreme Court has ever decided on right of publicity rights in 1977 involved Hugo Zucchini. He was a human cannonball. He made his living by getting shot out of a cannon at state fairs. And in this case, which wound up in the U.S. Supreme Court, Mr. Zucchini complained because a local newscaster had come to the state fair and taped his entire work, the entire show, all 15 seconds of it, and put it on the nightly news. And Mr. Zucchini said, no one will pay for a ticket to come see me at the fair. They can simply watch it on the news. It essentially destroyed his livelihood as a human cannonball. And the US Supreme Court struggled with how to recognize this kind of a right because it wasn't a traditional privacy right. He wasn't trying to keep private the fact that he was a human cannonball. In fact, he made money because people would pay to come to see him do this act. And in recognizing that even though this was a news program that had used his film, even though that was protected by the First Amendment, the Supreme Court in a 5-4 decision recognized that in what they considered a very, very unusual case, Mr. Zucchini had the right to pursue a claim against these news organizations. And that was a turning point in the law of right of publicity because the cases that used to be fairly evenly divided into commercial products on the one side and expressive works on the other side, all of a sudden you could have a lawsuit for right of publicity involving somebody who was suing a news organization or a publisher. But the Supreme Court decision doesn't explain how you draw the line between what is protected by the First Amendment and what is not. Everyone in the case, including the parties and all the justices, said this is a sui generis case. And because of that, the states were left to their own devices to come up with tests for applying this right of publicity when it involved an expressive work. Different states, different jurisdictions, depending on how the claims were being described, all of those things wound up in different tests. So for example, in California, the California Supreme Court came up with a test they called the transformative use test, borrowed from an element of copyright law. They said in a case involving t-shirts, if you're just using the celebrity's likeness on a t-shirt, and you're just not doing anything else with it, well, that's not transformative. You're not making something else creative out of that. You're just using their likeness. That's not protected by the First Amendment. But if you're doing something creative that has transformative elements, well, that would be protected by the First Amendment. Other states came up with a different test. Missouri said, well, we're going to look at whether the use is predominantly to make money. Are you predominantly focusing on the value of the celebrity as opposed to the artistic use? And if you're predominantly making money off of it, then we're going to let that claim proceed. Other states adopted a test from the Lanham Act genre where they said, well, if it's for any kind of artistic purpose, if you can draw a connection artistically to that use, and you're not explicitly misleading consumers about what their connection is to that particular use, then we think the First Amendment protects. And still other tests came up in states where they just simply tried to balance the various rights. What were the result of that, and I'm just gonna run through a few slides to set the stage for our discussion, wound up to be fairly chaotic. So for example, in the case I mentioned from California, they said a picture of the Three Stooges on lithographs and t-shirts was not protected by the First Amendment so that that claim could be pursued. Yet, in the same decision, the California Supreme Court said, well, but of course, Andy Warhol's portraits of Marilyn Monroe, those are artistic and those are protected by the First Amendment. The courts were confused, so the lower courts in another case said, well, what about a comic book that makes fun of these two songwriters, the Winter Brothers, but they put them in a comic book where they make them as half-worm creatures. And the California Supreme Court said, well, of course, if you make someone into a half-worm creature or a monster, that's transformative. That's protected by the First Amendment. But in Missouri, under the test that I mentioned, the predominant use test, they said making a creature, a mafia henchman out of a guy named, a hockey player named Tony Twist was his nickname, and having this henchman use the nickname Tony Twist, that's not protected under the First Amendment, and his claim was allowed to be proceeded. In New York, where they don't have the same kind of statute, they say anything is protected unless it's for trade or advertising purposes. They nonetheless have let a claim go forward brought by a convicted murderer on the grounds that it's not necessarily protected if you're saying something false. Yet in California, Olivia de Havilland's suit, where she said that an FX film about other people in her genre when she was an actress in Hollywood, had some false things about her, and she sued for right of publicity, among other claims, and the California Court of Appeals said, nope, that's protected, and by the way, it's also transformative, even though it portrayed her the way she appeared in real life. In this circuit, in a right of publicity case involving Jim Brown suing for Electronic Arts suing for video games, the Madden NFL games, which use statistics of players, a Lanham Act claim was found to be barred by the First Amendment because the test under the Lanham Act, they said this was still protected under the First Amendment because his participation in the game showing his statistics did have some artistic relevance to the game, and there was nothing explicitly misleading. Yet college football players bringing a state right of publicity claim, the court split 2-1 and said that's not protected under the transformative use test because you're not transforming the players. You're showing them the way they appeared in their everyday lives playing whatever the sport is that they're shown playing in the game. This all got very confusing until 2016, when I think this circuit has sort of set the stage under the First Amendment for what the test, at least in my obviously biased view, the test is that should be used going forward. This is a case involving the film The Hurt Locker, where a young man claimed, and probably rightfully so, that the film was based on incidents in his real life. And even though it was a fictional film, he said they took aspects of his life to make this film, and he didn't get paid for it. He didn't have a life rights agreement. He didn't get anything from the filmmakers, and he sued for violation of his right of publicity. And the Ninth Circuit stepped back from all the other tests that the different states, including California, had used, and said, if you look at what this claim really is, it's a content-based restriction on speech. And as we know from law school, content-based restrictions on speech are presumptively unconstitutional. And you can only allow them if there's a compelling state interest that's narrowly tailored to address that particular harm. And the Ninth Circuit talked about the Zucchini case and said Zucchini was different because there, the compelling interest was that you were taking his entire livelihood away by essentially replacing his act with something that was shown on television so no one would come to see him. No one's stopping this young man from pursuing a career as a bomb technician or from pursuing any other kind of career. And it doesn't fall in that very narrow bucket. But under the First Amendment, compelling strict scrutiny, the compelling interest test, they simply can't meet that standard. And this claim was then thrown out on First Amendment grounds. So until we get a decision from the US Supreme Court, we wind up with a sort of panoply of different tests that are being applied. But after the Hurt Locker decision, more courts are looking carefully at the underpinnings of the constitutional rights that are at issue and saying that perhaps this is the test that should be applied nationwide. I'll give you back your clicker.
Thank you, Kelly. So now we're all confused together, hopefully. and let's ask the panel if they can help us clear some of this up. But first, to set some context, Ben, why don't you talk to us? The MPAA has been very active in this space, as has SAG-AFTRA. Why don't you talk to us about what the interest of your members is and why the MPAA has taken the positions it has?
Sure. So first of all, thank you very much for having me. It's an honor to be here in front of this audience. So for many decades, the MPAA was not concerned about right of publicity for the reasons that Kelly just explained. It was limited to uses in advertising. I mean, if Coca-Cola were to take my image for some reason and put it on a billboard and say, buy Coke, I think pretty much everybody agrees and just about every state agrees that I should have a cause of action against Coca-Cola. That doesn't bother the movie studios back, it didn't bother the movie studios back then, it doesn't bother them today. The problem is that the tort has expanded and expanded and expanded, and plaintiffs have really tried to push the envelope to the point that many over the last half a century have made claims when real people are portrayed in movies, television shows, books, etc. Our position is very clear. That's all protected by the First Amendment. If we want to make a movie about a famous person like Mark Zuckerberg, we can. It's The Social Network. If we want to make a movie about a non-famous person like Sergeant Sarver, we can. It's fully protected by the First Amendment. Nonetheless, the plaintiffs keep coming and keep coming and keep coming. I mean, even after the Sarver case, we just saw, you know, we have the Porco case in New York, and Kelly really only mentioned it. Let me just say, this is probably the least sympathetic plaintiff on earth. The guy, he killed his father. He tried to kill his mother. He is currently serving a life sentence in upstate New York, and pro se filed a right of publicity suit against Lifetime based on this movie. The trial judge actually granted a TRO enjoining release of the broadcast of the show based on an alleged violation of his right of publicity. That was later overturned. The case is back at the trial court level now. But this is fundamental and actually existential in importance to our studios. And I did a little hardcore sort of data crunching here just to give a sense of how important this genre is to our members. So I looked at the last 5 years of Best Picture nominees. There's nine movies nominated each year. So over the last 5 years, 20 of 45, or 44% of the Best Picture nominees were either based on or inspired by real people or events. Let me just quickly tick through them just to remind you sort of how prominent this genre is these days. In 2017, we had Darkest Hour, Dunkirk, The Post. In 2016, Hacksaw Ridge, Hidden Figures, Lion. 2015, Spotlight, The Big Short, Bridge of Spies, The Revenant. 2014, American Sniper, The Imitation Game, Selma, and The Theory of Everything. And then lastly, in 2013, it was actually a majority. 12 Years a Slave, American Hustle, Captain Phillips, Dallas Buyers Club, Philomena, and The Wolf of Wall Street. And just the takeaway from that is that if these expansive versions of the right of publicity were to prevail, as plaintiffs keep on trying and trying and trying, most of these movies either couldn't have been made in the first place because the subject would not have given permission, or if they were forced to get permission, they wouldn't have been these interesting and sometimes, frankly, not so positive portrayals of the subjects, because of course no one would read the script and agree. I mean, Mark, if you needed to go to, let's put it this way, if you needed to go to Mark Zuckerberg and show him the script of The Social Network and say, hey, pretty please, can we have your permission to do this, there is zero chance that movie would have gotten made, at least in that form.
Duncan, you've been on the other side of this debate in a variety of fora. We'll talk about several of them, but can you give us a general sense on SAG-AFTRA's viewpoint on this and why you take a different approach?
Sure, and I think, I mean, first of all, good morning, and thank you for having me here. This is my first time at a Ninth Circuit Judicial Conference, so it's pretty exciting. I think the first and most key thing is to remember, and the Supreme Court recognized this in Zucchini, Ben described this as a tort. It's not a tort. This is an intellectual property right. It's a property right issue. It's not the right of privacy. It's right of publicity. And the development of the right, you know, it needs to be viewed in that framework. The people who have legitimate claims, I mean, we all know that people file illegitimate claims under any number of theories, you know, on every single day. The people who have legitimate claims under right of publicity laws are asserting a property right in a persona that they've developed at great cost to themselves, and just like the human cannonball is part of their livelihood, it's part of their work and their career. The people that I represent, which for those who aren't familiar with SAG-AFTRA, we represent professional performers, so actors, singers, dancers, we represent broadcast journalists, we represent recording artists, so basically many of the people who would likely be asserting claims under right of publicity are members of SAG-AFTRA. They have spent an entire lifetime developing and creating a commercial asset, which is their persona as a performer. And quite rightly, they don't want someone to take that asset and use it to generate revenue for other people instead of them. Just as the companies that Ben represents would fight vehemently and do fight vehemently every day in defense of their copyright rights, the people who are the actual creators of these works deserve to have their persona rights protected, and that was recognized by the Supreme Court. It's been recognized in the state statutes. I do think it would be great if we had a federal right of publicity law so that we could unify what is now a patchwork of different state laws, and I think part of the reason why you see so many different tests and the sort of jurisprudence is a bit confusing is because of that. And there's been a lot of discussion, about what a federal right of publicity might look like. But the reality is that that right now there's not a consensus between even the parties who are involved in it. Ben and his team and myself and my team have just been fighting this out in the state of New York in the legislature over a right of publicity bill there. In this case, one of the key issues being something I think we're going to talk about a little bit later, which is the new technology that lets people take someone's image and import it onto an existing performance. The most extreme example of which is something called deepfake porn, where basically performers' faces can be put onto somebody else's body and they can basically be imported into a pornographic film that's then distributed online. So, I mean, there are a lot of issues that need to be addressed here. And I do think that, you know, some of the examples that Kelly talked about, you know, they're examples of bad cases making bad law. And so the fact that this jurisprudence is still developing shouldn't be viewed as a reason to sort of discount the importance of the right to people who really, you know, I mean, the same reason that the Constitution embraces copyright is the reason why we need to embrace the right of publicity, because the reason for copyright is to make sure that creators can actually have an economic incentive to create. If we decide that people's personas and images, likenesses, can be taken without any compensation and used for commercial purposes or these hybrid commercial expressive purposes, then what we're going to do is take away the incentive for people to create. And as important as the companies are, and no one denies it, you know, certainly my members work because of the companies that employ them, it's important to remember that companies don't create things. People create things, and the companies create a forum in which that creation can occur. So it's really symbiotic, and even though we are on different sides of this issue, in the long run, we all want the same thing, which is an environment that fosters the kind of creativity that has made the United States the world's leader in the entertainment industry.
So, Lai, we've been talking on a kind of high level about all of this. You live with the uncertainty about the law and have to apply it as you produce films. Can you talk a little bit about what the problem is for you and in the practical world and how you go about putting together a project?
Yeah. So I think for us, because things are unclear, especially most recently with de Havilland, is that we employ an abundance of caution. So when, I mean, it's a little bit of a sliding scale. So my partner and I, all we do is we do projects that are based on or inspired by true stories. So we deal with this day in and day out. And Spotlight obviously is one example of that. But we look at a project and we always look, okay, our currency is the intellectual property. How can we protect our chain of title? How are we going to present to a buyer that we have something upon which we can point to and base our material on, that they will feel safe for the chain of title, that they have, that we have the legal rights to tell this story, and that we can go into production and get E&O insurance and all those things. So we look at a number of things. Is there a book? Is there an article or something like that that we can base this off of that would give us some sort of protection? And is the person that we're going to tell the story about, are they alive? If they're alive, then that's something that we look at really closely in terms of, do we need to get their life rights? And then we also look at, too, is it a public person or a private person? And I would say that if it's a private person for us, or somebody who has like a semi-public presence, then we definitely would try and get their life rights if they're alive, just to protect and be safe. For a public person, it kind of depends. For example, we have a project right now that we're working on that has to do with a policy that a White House policy that had been generated, and we got the rights to the high-level officials and policymakers and some outside people who were involved in that, but we did not get the rights to the President of the United States, the former President of the United States. Which we feel like we're pretty sure we're going to be in the clear. So I think the thing that's hard for us, though, is because of the confusion, we have to use an abundance of caution. And when we go get these, so if we make the decision that we do need to get the life rights because we can't proceed without them, then it's tricky, because not everybody wants to enter into a life rights agreement. And we are very aggressive in terms of when we do these agreements, because when we do an agreement with somebody, they are basically giving us carte blanche to tell their story in any way that we want to tell it. And they are not going to have approval rights. Can't have approval rights. If you have, they have any sort of approval, no buyer will buy this, no studio will make the movie, and you're dead in the water from the get-go. So when you try and enter into these agreements, people can, there's things that, beyond the creative control, there's also the financial component too, where a lot of people are looking to do these kinds of deals because they think you've come to Hollywood and they're going to make, this is going to set them up for life, where that is just not the case. So I think for us, the biggest thing is it would be great to have more clarity, clarification, and a general set of rules, if you will, to play by, so that we can have clarity about how to go about pursuing.
So let's make this a little more tangible. You ran into all of these issues in making Spotlight, in dealing with the real live people that were the subject of the story. Can you talk a little more about that?
Yeah. So Spotlight, that was a purely life right situation. There was no book, there was no article, in-depth article with a great point of view, anything like that. So we went to the reporters, and it was Marty Baron, Robbie Robinson, Sasha, Mike, and Ben and we got, and Matt Carroll, and we got their life rights. We felt like we needed to get those. We needed to have something to protect ourselves before going to buyers. And because we didn't have a book or an article, that's what we did. And they were, we were lucky. They were fantastic. And it was a pretty easy deal-making process, which is not always the case. However, we also tried to get the rights to Mitch Garabedian, who was the attorney played by Stanley Tucci in the movie. And we tried vigorously to get those rights and were unable to do that. And so we, rather than, we felt like he was a really integral part of the story, but we wanted to keep him in the story, we had to proceed with utter caution. So we were very, very careful in terms of how we portrayed him. And you know, at the end of the day, when we showed the movie, he was thrilled with how we portrayed him. And I think he came across incredibly well in the film, which served the film well. But again, we were very careful.
And let me just jump in for a second. Bly is referring to life rights. But yeah. I think we all should be clear. There is no legal requirement that you must obtain something called life rights in order to make, in order to tell a story about a real person. It is absolutely true that life rights is a common term, and people say, yes, I went and obtained somebody's life rights. But what, here's what that actually means, legally speaking. It means you get a release that says, I'm not going to sue you for invasion of privacy or violation of my right of publicity or defamation, et cetera. And you get cooperation, which yep. can just be in the form of sitting down and telling you what happened or providing written materials or photographs or videos or whatever. But as the California Court of Appeal just reaffirmed in the de Havilland case, legally speaking, there's no such thing as life rights which one must go and obtain before telling a story about a real person. And it's, I also thought it was very interesting the language that Bly just used. She says, you know, because of the uncertainty here, we proceed with an abundance of caution. Well, the law has a term, has a well-accepted term for that. It's called a chilling effect. Right. And the uncertainty and the you know, variety of different tests that different courts across the country apply in various different ways creates the need for an abundance of caution, or again, as lawyers would say, a chilling effect on speech, which hopefully someday I think the U.S. Supreme Court will need to step in and resolve once and for all.
And I'll say really quickly that the chilling effect, I will say if we feel like we can't get the life rights to somebody and there's no other book or an article or something like that, we will not do the project. I mean, we just won't do it because there's just too much risk involved. So,
well, yeah. I was going to ask you about this because I see a lot of documentary filmmakers who can't afford to buy life rights. I mean, is there a difference from your perspective or any of the panelists' perspective between a documentary film and a feature film that's scripted?
I mean, you want to do it?
No, go ahead.
I mean, I'm not a documentarian, you know, per se, officially. I mean, I know a little about the documentary filmmaker. My understanding, and you know, you obviously deal with these with documentary filmmakers all the time, so maybe you can speak to this. But is that oftentimes documentary filmmakers, it's all about exclusive access. So it's more about getting an agreement with them where you have exclusive access, where you're not actually buying, you know, getting their life rights for to be able to exploit in all mediums, and it's not like a buyout of their life rights or a specific portion of their life, but it's just access. So those agreements are a little bit different, oftentimes the financial remuneration is different too, where sometimes, you know, for access, some people it'll be a smaller exchange of money than a life rights buyout or no money at all. So I think there's a little bit of a difference there.
Duncan, from a legal perspective. Okay. Let me just add to that.
Yeah,
from
sure.
a legal perspective, there shouldn't be a difference at all from right of publicity claims. You get things with life rights, as Ben mentioned, that you wouldn't have without them, like access or cooperation. But from a legal perspective, under the First Amendment, there shouldn't be a difference. If you want to do a fictionalized film like The Hurt Locker, even though it's based on or inspired by real people or real events, you should be able to do that under the First Amendment without paying everyone who may have been in a particular platoon or may have been in the war because they may be referred to in some manner or something may have been inspired by something they did. If you don't have those protections under the First Amendment, what you're doing is constraining everything that creative people can write about or talk about or publish books about or do films about to things that are entirely made up. You may have science fiction stories, but you won't have any real life stories or even things inspired by real life stories, because the Hurt Locker film did not use this young man's name. It did not identify him in any way. It had a lot of other elements that were added to it that had nothing to do with him. But if his position had prevailed, you would never have a film that any creative person had been inspired by real life events or actually depicted them, whether in a documentary fashion or in a fictional fashion like a dramatization. And that, as Ben pointed out, completely wipes out a huge amount of our creative expression in this country. So that's why I think this has been such a high-pitched battle and a fairly new one that's only really come to this level in the last, you know, 5 or 10 years.
So,
If I can just
go ahead, Duncan.
Actually, this is an area where I don't think there is much disagreement between us, and I really appreciated what Ben and Kelly both had to say about the life rights issue, because that's really not, in my mind, what right of publicity is about. And I do think that there's, you know, this is something that happens where, you know, there's an extreme case, there's a bad case that is disposed of by the courts, but people hear about it and they start thinking, oh, I need this. And there is, I believe that there is a general sense that life rights are required in Hollywood. It is certainly a common practice. I think as much for business reasons as for legal reasons. I also think, and the lawyers in the room, which probably is everybody, can sympathize with this, which is I think that, you know, sometimes, you know, when you are in the real world, lawyers make things seem more legally required because they think it's a good business decision than they actually are. And so I think there are plenty of, you know, Hollywood lawyers who use that angle to try and convince people that they need life rights when they don't actually need them. They may want them for all the access reasons, et cetera. But the right of publicity is much narrower than those types of concerns, and it's much, you know, it's much more specific in my mind. And, you know, there are other rights out there that take care of, you know, the types of, some of the other types of concerns that people might have that aren't related to their property right and their own persona. And so, you know, for those of us who really strongly believe in the right of publicity and know how necessary and important it is, it's very troubling when people sort of like lump it all together with this general sense of rights that people might want to get as far as making projects. I mean, you know, the laundry list that you gave, Ben, of the Best Picture, you know, nominees, you know, that are related to real life events, you know, how many of them, was there any significant litigation over right of publicity? As far as I'm aware, zero. As far as documentaries go, if anyone hasn't seen it, there's an amazing documentary about Whitney Houston that's out right now that I can assure you, if you watch it, you will conclude that there's no way that the people involved had any control over how they were presented in that documentary, other than maybe one of them. So, you know, I think that there is a really, you know, there may be, I don't know if there's really a chilling effect. I mean, I guess when I was thinking about it, and I mean, Spotlight is an amazing movie, and I know you were talking about the lawyer who was sort of one of the, if you had a protagonist, one of the protagonists of the movie. But, you know, maybe there's an argument to be made, not from a legal perspective, but in a general perspective, that, you know, using caution when portraying participants in real life events as real life events is something people should do. Obviously, the Havilland case doesn't exactly support that position at this point. But if we were talking about one of the accused, you know, one of the accused, you know, people in Spotlight, I would hope that they, you know, that care would be used in their depiction, so that when someone sees that, you know, it is, if it's purported to be based on real life events, it is in fact based on real life events. But that's not what the right of publicity is for or about, really. And so I just hope we can distinguish it.
Well, that's really interesting, because Thag took the position in the de Havilland case. I mean, set aside defamation and invasion of privacy, because that's not what this particular claim is about. If you defame someone or you invade their privacy by revealing private information about them that's not newsworthy, there are claims that address those things. But in the de Havilland case, SAG's position supported Olivia de Havilland's view that because she was not paid and she was portrayed in the movie, which was based on real life events, setting aside whether she thought she was also defamed or not, she sued for right of publicity violations, and SAG filed a brief supporting her view that she should have a right of publicity claim because she was not paid for her portrayal in this dramatized film. So I find it interesting that the position seems to be changing.
Hang on, let me ask you to back up for a second, Kelly. Could you just set the context for those who are not familiar with the de Havilland case, since we're about to have a brawl about it? let's make sure that everybody in the audience knows what happened there, and because the facts are really interesting, and I think they set up this debate very nicely.
Olivia de Havilland is still alive. She's 102, I believe, now, having just celebrated a birthday. And FX had a film that came out a couple of years ago called The Feud, which was really about the feud between actresses Bette Davis and Joan Crawford that related to their participation in a particular movie. Olivia de Havilland was part of the Hollywood entertainment era, and so she was part of what happened during those days when that particular feud was going on. And she is depicted in the film, played by an actress, I think very lovely actress, and she was depicted in the film. But she was not paid. She was not did not have life rights that anybody paid her for. She was not asked to participate in the movie and get money for it. And she sued the filmmakers, FX, and everyone involved in the film for a variety of claims, including defamation. She claimed that there were false things said about her that hurt her reputation. But she also sued for right of publicity. And a slap statute was brought in California state court addressing those claims. And her response to the slap statute on the First Amendment argument being made was that there is a custom and practice in Hollywood of paying people. If you're going to depict them in a film, you pay them for their life rights, and had an expert declaration presented to the trial judge that that's the custom and practice in the Hollywood entertainment industry. And based on that declaration, the trial judge found disputed issues of fact about whether this should be protected speech or whether this custom and practice meant that she had a right of publicity that should be allowed to proceed, and rejected the slap motion. And at that point, it went up into the Court of Appeal. So that's the underlying facts that led to the case being in the Court of Appeal, which briefs were filed by everyone in this podium, I think, except Bly.
So, Duncan, talk to us about SAG's position in the case.
Well, sir, I mean, and the reason I try to jump in there, Kelly, is because, I mean, I do want to be really clear, and I invite everyone to look at our brief if there's any question about it. You know, our involvement in that, you know, Olivia de Havilland is a member of SAG, actually one of our first members and one of our most senior members of SAG, AFTRA. But we were very clear in our brief. You know, our concern was the impact that case was going to have on the interpretation of the transformative use test that you talked about earlier. And so we did not file a brief with a blanket support of Ms. de Havilland's claims. My personal opinion is that, you know, as you said, you know, some of the things she was concerned about should have been primarily addressed by her defamation-related claims rather than a right of publicity claim. But, you know, we don't get to choose the cases that are filed. We have to respond to the cases that exist, as I'm sure probably is a feeling that everyone in this room has. And so we were very concerned about what might happen with the transformative use test, and rightly so, it turned out. And so we filed a brief that was entirely focused on that one specific issue, which is how the court should look at the transformative use test, because even though she won in the trial court, and the trial court judge, she won on the anti-slap motion in the trial court, there were already rumblings in what was written by the trial court that concerned us about a misunderstanding of what the transformative use test meant and was. And so that's why we filed a brief in that case. We would have very much liked the California Supreme Court to take up the opinion. It's ironic, I'm sure this happens for everyone here, but two of the three Court of Appeal judges on that case are personal friends of mine, and yet they went entirely the wrong way. I don't understand how that happened. But
depends on your perspective. But, we think they went the right way.
I'm sure it's an occupational hazard for everyone in this room. But we really would have liked the California Supreme Court to take that case up and address some of those issues. Obviously, they did not choose to do that. So we'll have to wait for another day to address them. But I think too much has been read into our support of that specific part of Ms. de Havilland's case, and we're really concerned about the jurisprudence of right of publicity, not the specific facts that she alleged, and, you know, we just have to
And Duncan, I want to come back to the jurisprudence in a second, but Ben...
I'm just going to jump in and ask Duncan the sort of the nub of the question here. I mean, Olivia de Havilland took the position that FX was not allowed to portray her in this docudrama unless it got her permission. That was her position, which she argued in the trial court and the California Court of Appeal. What is SAG's position about whether FX is required to get the consent of a real person in order to portray them in a docudrama?
So our position is that that specifically the trial court and the Court of Appeal looked at this from a transformative use test perspective. Our belief is that's not the right test to be looking at for the issue that you're raising, Ben. So let me first say, from a transformative use test perspective, we believe that it was clearly not transformative. I mean, even Kelly made that point in the beginning of this and showed the clip. Or
well,
the
but
still.
I disagree with you, actually. I think it was transformative, and so did the Court of Appeal, but
well, okay, but when you said that earlier, you said, you know, she was portrayed exactly as she appeared in real life, and, you know, that was not an attempt to transform her appearance. The actions were purportedly what allegedly actually occurred, et cetera. What we think applies in this case is a public affairs, public interest test. And I think that's what actually protects the kind of expressive use that, Ben, your companies are concerned about, Kelly, presumably your clients are concerned about, and that's actually why you don't have and shouldn't have, you know, a panoply of right of publicity claims related to all those Best Picture nominees that you described. But where you're going to rely, or where someone is going to rely on a transformative use test as their defense, we think that it ought to be correctly applied. And we think in the Satterup case, the Three Stooges case that Kelly, you showed the image of, we think that was absolutely the right decision. And you know, it really hasn't been, you know, highly criticized or challenged, in my view. Some of the other cases here have been. And, you know, this is part of a developing jurisprudence, but in our view, we're not suggesting, nor do we want, you know, a chilling effect on the creation of, you know, biopics or, you know, stories inspired by real life events or anything like that. And, I mean, obviously, my members work in those very projects that you are creating, and they would like to continue to do so. So that's not the issue. The issue, as I said at the very beginning, from our point of view, is when you take somebody's, you know, property right in their own persona, name, image, likeness, et cetera, and you misuse that for commercial purposes, and drawing that dividing line, that's where this battle is happening. And by the way, in large part, because the companies have chosen to create this gray area. You know, it used to be easy to distinguish advertising from expressive content, right? I mean, 20 years ago, everybody knew the difference between a commercial and a TV show. Now, in a TV show, there's all kinds of commercial content embedded in that. The companies, for business reasons, have chosen to blur the lines between commercial and expressive works, and I think that's a significant part of why we have the complicated jurisprudence in what we're dealing with.
And Duncan, we're going to look at a couple of those kinds of cases in a couple of minutes, but Kelly, I want to give you a chance to respond.
Well, I mean, it's interesting, again, to hear this, because there's no real test articulated that I think any of our clients would be able to follow coming out of SAG, where they're saying, you know, yes, we're not saying you can't do it, but we're actually not saying you can do it either, because FX, this film, is a feature film that was on television. This is not showing Olivia de Havilland in this film holding up a Coke can in a way that she says, well, now you're making it look like I'm promoting Coke. She was complaining because she didn't get paid for a film that depicted events that related to her real life. It didn't depict her as a half-worm creature. It didn't turn her into some horrible monster. She probably would have been less happy if that had happened, frankly, than having a beautiful actress portray her. But she said, I should get paid if you're getting money off of this. And the concern that we have is that's the position that SAG seemed to be taking, both in the Court of Appeal, which rejected those claims out of hand, and in the California Supreme Court, which declined to hear it. But the California Supreme Court did two things. It looked at Sarver and said, this is plainly protected speech under the First Amendment. And it recited the findings of Sarver and said that, you know, you have to have a compelling interest. You have to apply these very strict constitutional tests. But the court also said, even if you applied the transformative use test, which has been actually highly criticized ever since it was adopted, and many courts have been confused as to how it's supposed to be applied, including the courts of appeal that then led to later decisions, it's not a good test, because what some courts have said is, well, that must mean you have to turn the person into something else, like a monster or a worm, otherwise it's not being transformed. But that's not what the California Supreme Court said. They borrowed one aspect of copyright law in a case involving a tangible product, t-shirts, and said, when you're dealing with that kind of thing, then it has to be something more than just slapping a celebrity's face on a t-shirt. And the Court of Appeal in de Havilland said, that test may be great if you're talking about a product. It doesn't work when you're talking about expressive works.
All right, if I can just add one more thing, because you know, I think, Kelly, you make a lot of good points. I don't think it's really fair to say that Olivia de Havilland's position is that she should have gotten paid, and that's what her main complaint is. Her main complaint is that she was portrayed inaccurately, that words were put in her mouth that were not true, And I can see you shaking your head, Ben, but...
No, her position was they were not allowed to portray me in that movie unless and until they got my consent.
That's right, consent. But I mean, the way that was just framed was as a money grab, right? I mean, that's how I would characterize what you just said, Kelly. She wanted to get paid to be in that TV right. series, and she didn't get paid, and so therefore she was mad. I just don't think that's an accurate portrayal at all of her interest in it. And again, I'm not here to, I don't represent her personally. I represent 160,000 people like Olivia de Havilland. But you know, that's just, you know, she has stated many times that her concern was the way she was depicted, the statements that were put in her mouth about her sister, Joan Fontaine, et cetera, et cetera. And yes, she wanted consent, but I think just characterizing it as she wants money is not really a fair way to put it.
We'll have to respectfully agree to disagree on that point.
And I'll just say, like, from a filmmaker, creative standpoint, you know, for me, I hear you know this in terms of protecting the rights of performers and stuff, and I start to wonder, well, how far does that extend? Like, for example, like our project with the president and former president of the United States, like, does that mean that, you know, I would have to go get his permission and go, you know, would he have to be paid? But like, where does the line get drawn and who does it apply to? I guess that's from a creative standpoint.
So you're still confused and you're not going to change your business practices.
Totally.
Fair enough. That's what my clients are generally like as well. All right. So let's step back from the debate on this subject for a moment, talk about a slightly different debate, which is, Bly, you brought up earlier that there's some difference in your mind between people who are alive and people who are dead. One of the places where the law is also in conflict from state to state and court to court relates to descendability of the right of publicity. And Kelly, could you just set that context for us as well?
Sure. So in California years ago, there was a case that came up to the California Supreme Court where the heirs of a celebrity had sued based on the use of his likeness, Bela Lugosi's likeness, on a bunch of merchandising things. And the California Supreme Court said, these are essentially privacy rights. That's where right of publicity actually derived from. In with due respect to what Duncan said, they derived from privacy, and those rights are not descendable. So unless there's a statute that makes them descendable, the heirs don't have any rights. And so the heirs' claims were thrown out. Then lo and behold, the California legislature, lobbied very heavily by certain unions, passed a statute that gave the heirs of individuals descendable rights of publicity. So someone could transfer or have their rights descend to their heirs, and now many, many states have passed similar laws. And what that means is if you're trying to do a project which involves real people or real events, and there's another slide that I'll show here, just one recent case involving a great little film called The Debaters about an African-American team of debaters that went and debated, in the film they're depicted as debating Harvard. And the heirs of some of the individuals portrayed in that sued, saying, well, we own those rights, those descended to us. You can't make a film about those historical people without paying us because we own the rights that they otherwise would have if they were still alive. So even though in a regular privacy case, invasion of privacy for private facts, the heirs can't sue for a violation of someone's right of privacy. But because of state laws that have now expanded widely, and many of them have either very long statutes of limitation or no limits at all, so it could be upwards of 25 or 50 or 100 years, or no limit at all to how long those rights belong to the heirs, you can have an untold number of people who may claim that they own the rights of publicity, and therefore they're in the position that Olivia de Havilland claimed she was in, which you have to pay me in order to use those rights. And just to set the stage a little bit for what that means, not only for filmmakers and documentarians, but just imagine a very popular certain musical that hit Hollywood. Now, would the heirs of Alexander Hamilton and Aaron Burr and everyone else portrayed in Hamilton then have a claim? Because surely it's a money-making enterprise. There's a lot of merchandise that's been sold based on the musical Hamilton. And you have a lot of very real people who are being portrayed as they were in real life, although they probably didn't rap, but they actually were people who were the founding fathers of this country. And do their heirs then have the right of publicity to claim that they should get paid for any money that's being made on that production? I find that a very scary prospect.
Well, I mean, I think it's clear that they don't. I mean, you know, you referenced the California statute. Another interesting point about the California statute is that it has an express exemption for expressive works. So, you know, there would be, in my view, zero possibility that could ever happen under the California statute. Obviously, this has been developing, you know, on a state-by-state basis. And so one of the things that I think, you know, is frustrating, I could imagine being frustrating for, you know, for lawyers, for producers and producers, is the fact that there is this variation from state to state in what the, you know, the parameters of right of publicity are. Having said that, yes, we strongly support the descendability of right of publicity. It's a property right, just like any other property right. It should be descendable, you know, just like, you know, any type of tangible property or other intangible property that you have. So unless there's some reason it should evaporate upon your death, your heirs, your children, your spouse should be able to, you know, benefit from the economic value created by that property right. But you know, again, our view is not that, you know, this type of project, whether it's Hamilton, whether it's The Great Debaters, which is a great movie, I agree with you, but I urge people to see it, you know, it's those are not the kinds of scenarios that we are concerned about. Obviously, those projects get created, the vast majority of them, there's no litigation whatsoever, at least relating to right of publicity. You know, I think that there's a certain element of this that is overstated in terms of the impact that it has, you know, in the real world. And I think part of it is that people unfortunately generate fear of claims that are unjustified. But the fact of the matter is we do need to have further clarity in the jurisprudence so that people are clear on what the various tests or balancing are, just like for other intellectual property rights that compete with the First Amendment. There's got to be, you know, as much clarity as possible in defining it. You know, the fair use test and copyright is not exactly a, you know, a model of clarity, and yet no one is out here arguing that we should get rid of fair use. So, you know, thankfully we have a judiciary, we have legislatures, and we have people who can continue to evolve this in a way that we can hopefully, you know, make it clearer over time.
Ben, let me just point out the chilling effect is real. Okay. We've talked a little bit about this Porco case in upstate New York, and you can say, well, it was just, you know, sort of an outlier decision by a judge in a rural county in upstate New York who's probably not familiar with, you know, hadn't seen a lot of right of publicity cases in his career. We filed an amicus brief recently in the New York Court of Appeals, the highest court there, that Kelly did for us in a case involving Lindsay Lohan, where we pointed out that plaintiff's lawyers are already routinely citing this Porco case and the fact that it got past a motion to dismiss, saying, hey, you're portraying my client in a docudrama. You're not allowed to do that, at least under New York law, without getting our permission. And yes, it's partly about consent. It's partly about money. But I think the consent part is absolutely the most important and the most salient part. I mean, they are saying, you are not allowed to portray me in a docudrama unless you get my permission. That is the definition of censorship. That is totally anathema to the First Amendment. And we still have, even if it's just a few random scattered cases out there, those get cited in the claim letters that our studios receive on a weekly basis.
Routinely, and even if the studios decide, we've got lawyers, we don't think this is the right interpretation of the law, we can defend a claim, and so that we'll go forward with this project, and they can make that business decision. But if you're a small filmmaker, if you're a documentary filmmaker where you don't have a lot of resources, or you're somebody on a project where you need to get insurance, and the insurers are saying, well, what's the law? Are we sure that you can do this without getting their consent, without getting their life rights? Then those are the people at the margins who's really going to be chilled, because those are the areas where they don't have the resources to have the fight, even if they think they're going to win.
And with all due respect, Duncan, I think you have an example of somebody who feels chilled and impacted by the state of the law sitting next to you. So I don't think it's all exaggerated. But let me ask you a question. You said before that you believe there should be some kind of public interest exception or a rule that layers on top of right of publicity. That sounds a lot like privacy law. Privacy law does not allow for descendability. So why the distinction here? Why take publicity beyond the grave but not privacy beyond the grave?
Well, I think mainly because of the nature of the right of publicity. And I mean, I would be fine if we wanted to come up with a different name for it so that it's not, you know, it doesn't like look so directly related. You know, I think a privacy right is not a property right. The publicity right is and should be it's a property right. It is something, it's intangible, just like copyright, just like, you know, a patent, just like a trademark, but it is nonetheless an intellectual property right that's created through the work and effort and generally very long-standing and concerted work and effort of somebody that creates something of economic value that didn't exist before and that wouldn't exist without their effort. And
so you would limit it to people who are celebrities or people who have some kind of public persona already. You wouldn't have right of publicity claims for people like Mr. Sarver who are not celebrities then.
I think the Sarver case is a terrible case from my point of view in the sense that nobody seriously asserts that someone who is not referenced at all in a work like that where just, you know, factual events occurred and some element of them then is incorporated into a project that doesn't have any attachment to them whatsoever should have a right of publicity claim. I wouldn't describe it as it should only apply to celebrities because I think that conveys the impression that you have to have a certain level of fame or whatever. I think you could be a non-celebrity who nonetheless has a developed persona. Perhaps in a narrow field, but one that's still of value. To me, the question is the economic value that exists there and the right of somebody else to take something of economic value that you've created and use it for their benefit without, you know, compensating you for it.
All right, so let me put this to the panel. Let's take a not terribly hypothetical situation. We're all familiar with the Thai soccer team that was just saved from drowning or asphyxiation in a cave, and two different film companies have already announced they are going to do documentaries about their story. Bly, let's start with you. If you decided that you wanted to do a film about the Thai soccer team, what would you do and how would you approach it?
Well, I think because it's happening so quickly and in real time, clearly there's no book and there's nobody who's written that great, you know, Vanity Fair article or anything of those yet. So you're really, if you want to jump on the story right away, I would not do that story unless I was able to go out there and get the rights to the kids and the coach. And maybe some of the rescuers too. And I think one of the other tricky things is just because they're semi-public figures for this event, but they're not celebrities. They're not a well-known, you know, public politician who's been around for a long time. So. I mean, to proceed with an abundance of caution, I would do that. Number one, just for the rights and just the legal, you know, tying it up. And number two is it is a way to scare off other competitors who might also want to do the story because we're all running scared. So if I get the rights, then somebody else probably would back off and not do it because they would be worried because I had the rights, even if I didn't need the rights, that because I had them, they wouldn't pursue it.
So Duncan, under your approach, does a filmmaker need the rights from the kids or the soccer coach to tell this story, either in a documentary or a feature film?
In my view, no, they don't. Now, I just gave some really good reasons why you might want them, whether it's to scare off competition so you don't end up with something else, or more likely, since, so far as I know, a lot of the probably most interesting things happen inside a cave, you know, underground, and only the people present actually know what happened, so you might need them to tell you and cooperate so you could create the best possible story. I can see lots of reasons why you'd want them, but I don't think right of publicity is one of them.
Kelly?
On that, we agree.
Based on your experience, is there likely to be a lawsuit brought on behalf of the Thai boys if there's a film about them?
Well, I am the first to admit I know absolutely zero about Thai right of publicity law, but in the U.S., I think we're all in agreement that you have a First Amendment. Anyone who tells this story, whether it's in a newspaper, a magazine, a show like 2020, which I just read yesterday, is already going to do their second like special episode about this event, or a documentary filmmaker or a maker of a docudrama like Feud has the right to tell this story. Are there advantages to obtaining so-called life rights? Absolutely. You get to have access to them. You can say, hey, I'm going to pay you this amount of money, and you're required to sit down for interviews until I exhaust your memory. But will there be litigation? There's always litigation.
Yeah. Inevitably. Inevitably, because the law is unclear. There will be someone who doesn't get any money, who doesn't have their life rights purchased, who wants to do the project and wants to stop someone else from doing the project if they did get the life rights, who's going to say, we own it, you can't touch it, or you didn't pay me and I'm going to sue you for it. Because when the same similar kind of circumstance happened, and I believe it was Columbia Miners, there were several claims that were filed from people who said, you didn't pay me anything for my life rights and yet you're using me in your film. Or who said, we bought the life rights and now you're using them in your film and we want to stop you and monopolize those rights because we actually did pay somebody for them. So that's where you wind up with litigation. And the small filmmakers or the people who are mostly risk adverse are not going to be able to do the story if they don't feel like they've got legal cover. And that's why the law does need to be more clear. And that point Duncan and I agree on.
So one other thing too is
this tie story breaks, right? From a filmmaker standpoint, you think about, okay, well, wait a minute, I'm trying to get my head around the facts and the story. Who am I going to tell this story? Whose point of view am I going to tell this through? Wait a minute, who are the main characters? So early, you have to make a guess, and then you try and get those people's rights who you think are going to be the main part. But that might change over time, too. And then you're like, oh, my God, I don't have the other person's rights. Well, now they have leverage because they know you've sunk time and effort into getting these other people's rights. Plus, you have to stack them because you've already negotiated these other deals, and now you realize you have to go back and get the rights for somebody else. And it may price you out of, like, the, you know, of the marketplace because now your development costs are so high that, that nobody wants to buy it. And, you know, and so it gets really tricky when you're trying to account for all these people in an evolving story. And how many people's rights do you get? How much of a role do they have to have in the film before you go get their rights versus just either proceeding without them or just trying to get a release later on or something like that?
Which I think is an excellent point. If you're talking about particularly historical events, broad events have lots of different people that are involved in it, and it doesn't have to be the main focus of the story that you may actually decide you want to get the life rights for so you get cooperation. But all those other people who are also being depicted, who are essentially peripheral to the story, but they're nonetheless involved, those people are going to claim their piece of the pie too. And we see those claim letters, we see those demands, and I know Ben Dunn as well. We see those actual lawsuits being filed on a regular basis. So it's not a hypothetical. It actually does happen, and it happens on a regular basis.
Well, that's a good segue. Let's go back to the real world and talk about a couple of real cases that have happened that particularly touch on Duncan's point about how content, expressive content and advertising content have started to merge together. So here's the first one to talk about. Which involves Michael Jordan. For those of you who have ever lived in Chicago, Michael Jordan has a status that is truly unlike almost any other Chicagoan in history. You know, maybe Abe Lincoln for the state of Illinois.
maybe.
So when Michael Jordan was inducted into the Hall of Fame several years back, Sports Illustrated did an issue of the magazine to honor him, and two different local grocery stores did advertisements that were inserted into the magazine. The one on the left is from Jewel Osco and shows basically his shoes and his number. The one on the right has his number, his name, and a very unfortunate coupon for $2 off on a steak. The one on the right, both of these triggered lawsuits. The one on the right triggered a lawsuit that for reasons that are still somewhat unclear to me, the parties stipulated to liability on right of publicity under the Illinois statute and went to a damages trial against Michael Jordan in Chicago. Yeah. The result, as most of you could probably guess, was not very good for the advertiser. $8.9 million. They subsequently settled. The one on the right moved to strike, Jewel Osco moved to strike because it was less commercial in appearance. And in fact, the trial court judge granted the motion to strike and said, look, this is honoring Michael Jordan. And yes, they took advantage of the opportunity to promote Jewel Osco and put their logo in the middle of the ad, but this is expressive content and it doesn't violate the statute. That case went up to the Seventh Circuit. The Seventh Circuit reversed and said that this was a jury question, that it appeared to be a violation of right of publicity, and that a jury could decide whether or not it satisfied the test that the Seventh Circuit is applying. The case subsequently settled for an undisclosed amount. I'm curious what your reactions to the case, you know, these cases are. I mean, obviously the coupon changes things, but to a
much
certain extent,
facts, yes.
both cases turn on the intent of the creator of the advertising. Is that an appropriate standard, one that can be applied in any consistent fashion ever?
No, I think that's troubling from a perspective of defending these claims. And I have to say, when I saw the Jewel Osco, this promotional thing that they had done that was deemed to be commercial speech, and they wound up having to pay an undisclosed amount of money, the first thing that came to mind were all of these honoring books that we do at all of these charity events where some celebrity is being honored and every law firm in town buys an ad where you say, congratulations to celebrity, and then you have your firm logo at the bottom. And I wonder, are we going to have a raft of lawsuits now against all these firms? Because we're doing exactly what Jewel Osco did, except it did it in a little more prominent fashion. The idea that you can't turn advertising into content just by adding some content to an ad, I don't think is that troubling to the clients that I represent, and I think that's fairly well established. In one of the cases from our circuit that happened a long time ago, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar sued General Motors because they had an ad for cars where they did a little promotional thing that said, and you know, can you answer this question about who was Lew Alcindor? And actually, you know, it was Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, and he's the greatest. Our cars are also the greatest. Well, the court said that that's an ad, and that didn't get challenged or cause too much consternation. But when you're actually talking about content that may be sponsored, that's where I think we start to get trouble, because television programs, newspapers, magazines, all have sponsors. That's how they get money to actually do the content. And so if you say anything that's sponsored becomes advertising, or you have anything that connects those two things where you're actually promoting what it is you're doing, that becomes advertising. I think that becomes very troubling.
So Duncan, you talked about this merging of advertising and expressive content, and this is one example of that. What's your reaction? How does this apply in the world that you would set up in your jurisprudence?
Well, you know, I'm sure you're shocked to hear that I think both of those cases came out just exactly right. The one to the right, as you said, I mean, I don't really see how anyone could possibly argue that that's not advertising. I mean, there's a coupon, for God's sake. I mean, really. The one on the left, I mean, you know, I see the point. I mean, I think to me, the determination that it should be, that's an issue of fact, is right. I think, you know, if I were, you know, a trier of fact looking at this, I think it's interesting that Jewel Osco's name is bigger than his number on the shoes. You know, this is not like a discreet, you know, we're going to acknowledge Michael Jordan and here's, you know, a little note at the bottom, it's from Jewel Osco. I mean, this is really about them. But, I mean, that's a factual determination, and I think they were right to decide that the way they did. As far as, you know, other types of you know, embedded content, I agree with Kelly, the fact that something is sponsored in and of itself, that's not what I'm talking about, right? That doesn't turn expressive content into an advertisement. What I'm talking about is a more of a blurring of the lines than that, and I think probably the easiest place to see that is more so in the world of video games than it is in the world of, you know, events clients. Well, if you take, there have been some cases, but I think rather than focusing on cases, let's just use a hypothetical. You know, if you take a video game that includes, you know, literal depictions of let's say performers, for example, alongside content inside the game that is clearly an advertisement. So let's say, for example, you have members of a rock band performing in front of a billboard for a specific product, like not a hypothetical product, a real life product, right? And they haven't consented to that, but the impression that that has given to everyone who's playing that video game is that they're now, the members of this rock band are aligned with this product, they are promoting this product because, you know, they would never do it in a live show, but in the video game, there's a huge advertisement for a product right behind them as they perform. That's the kind of thing that you see happening in video games that, you know, so far, thankfully, I haven't seen that in the work that's produced by the companies that Ben, and I'm not exactly sure, Kelly, who all you represent, because I know
everyone.
anyone who wants to challenge one of these.
Kelly, what's your reaction to, have you as their to lawyer, that? Because yeah. It sounds to me not unlike what a newspaper does, where there are articles or features next to advertisements, and so.
Well, and the interesting thing about that is because when you're doing a video game, and now they've become very much like feature films in a sense, because you have very, very much more sophisticated elements that are included in video games, and the U.S. Supreme Court has said that they are protected speech just like films and books and other kinds of expressive works. But if you're creating a scenario where people are interacting in a video game, in what looks like real life. So it's not some, you know, something up in space, but it's actually people going down the streets. Well, on every normal street, you actually have real billboards, and you have buildings, and you have cars. And if the issue is you can't put any real things that exist in the real world into that environment because that may suggest some kind of connection, to me that makes no sense because you have all of those same things in a feature film. You would have Olivia de Havilland driving a car just like she did in real life, or you would have cars on the street. And if you say you can't put real products or real things in that film because that might suggest there's some connection, that's not what the law says, and that to me doesn't make any more sense in video games than it makes in feature films.
Yeah, but that's not what I was saying, to be fair. So I'm not saying that, you know, I didn't say the rock band can't play a guitar made by, you know, a prominent guitar manufacturer. There's a difference between interacting with real life occurrences. I mean, actually, this would be an example coming from one of your companies. You know, there have been television series in the past, fortunately this seems to have gone out of popularity, where the performers were actually scripted, you know, they're driving up in a car and they're actually scripted to say, oh my gosh, is this the new, you know, Honda blah, blah, blah? I mean, don't you love how quiet it is as we're, you know, sneaking in and hopefully no one's gonna notice we're here, right? And what I think happened in the real world was people realized that's so jarring, nobody wants to see that in a television series and they've stopped doing it. But, you know, that's different than just, well, hopefully, so you're saying no. I haven't seen
I'm
it
not
recently.
Sure.
But, I mean, that is a different thing than just there being, you know, physical. I mean, obviously, you have to have physical, tangible objects in order to portray a story. But there's a difference between that and actually doing something that is a paid promotional activity where someone is being linked together to a product. I mean, I completely disagree that those are the same thing.
Yeah, let me just go to this issue of video games, because I think it's something we've only touched on, but it's really fascinating. So we just had a kumbaya moment a few minutes ago where we all agreed that whether it's in a book or a magazine or a newspaper or a movie or a documentary about the rescue of the Thai soccer team from the cave, that you don't need to get, you have a First Amendment right to do that, at least here in the US. Well, what if it was a video game where your goal was to help rescue these people from the cave? Now, as Kelly alluded to, about a decade ago, the U.S. Supreme Court decided a case called Brown versus Entertainment Merchants Association, which was not a right of publicity case. It was a case about a California statute that restricted the sale and rental of violent video games to kids. And in an opinion written by Justice Scalia, the U.S. Supreme Court struck it down under the First Amendment and said, just as Kelly alluded to, that video games have the same degree of First Amendment protection as more traditional forms of media like books, newspapers, movies, et cetera. That's the law of the land. The U.S. Supreme Court said that. I don't think judges believe it. And I don't think they apply it in practice. I think in most judges' mind, there is a hierarchy of First Amendment protection. And at the top are books and newspapers. Just below that are movies and television shows. And then somewhere down here are video games. And what we've seen is there's been a series of cases, I know Kelly has been personally involved in several of them, brought by professional or college sports players against video game makers that reference them in some way, even if it's not making characters that actually resemble them, at least using their statistics, et cetera. And for the most part, the plaintiffs, the sports players, have prevailed. At least they've gotten past an anti-slap motion or a motion to dismiss. Again, despite what the U.S. Supreme Court has said, I think most judges just somewhere in their gut do not feel like video games are the same as movies, even though today a lot of them share many, many, many attributes.
Absolutely.
With movies. They have plot, they have character, they have elaborate setting, they have, most of the attributes that movies have, with the added one that you actually can control the characters.
And in fairness, the video game cases that came up during a certain period of time, there were several of them across the country, were all cases in which the transformative use test was the test applied by the court. And in the appellate courts, that was the test applied because that's what had been argued below. So appellate counsel, and I will admit that I was, you know, that's the test I'm stuck with as appellate counsel if that's what's been argued below. And in applying that test, courts came to different conclusions about what that test means. And if you're not transforming in the sense that you're not turning them into something that they're not, or you're portraying portraying them the way they were in real life. Some courts said that's not transformative, but they didn't apply the strict scrutiny test that's now been argued and adopted in another panel involving the Hurt Locker case. But having those decisions on the books, and they remain on the books in a number of jurisdictions, has created this sense that video games are somehow different, or if you're portraying someone as they appeared in real life, then you don't get protection, whatever the genre is, because if video games are just like films and books, and you're not protected doing that, then you're not protected for films and books either. And there was even a lawsuit filed by, believe it or not, Manuel Noriega, who sued in Los Angeles because there was a video game that had a despotic tyrant in it, and he said, that's me. They're portraying me in that video game the way I was in real life.
And in fairness, it did look a lot like him.
and
what
so
happened?
The Los Angeles Superior Court judge said, with due respect to the Ninth Circuit and the Third Circuit, I'm not bound by you. And this is protected by the First Amendment, and he threw the case out. And the Noriega lawyers chose, and he chose not to appeal. But the fact that that lawsuit was brought, I think, just sort of showed us how far the pendulum seemed to have swung using that particular test and involving video games.
All right, see, so let's go
well,
from
there. If I can just say, yeah. I mean, I think, you know, I mean, really, the, you know, the, you know, I don't think that it's fair to attribute all of that to the transformative use test. And we always, you know, there's always going to be weird and unpleasant cases filed by odd people, which will be good for a chuckle, you know, whether it's Manuel Noriega or a convicted murderer, et cetera. But, you know, that's the beauty of the law is it applies to everyone, and we don't get to choose who the plaintiffs are. But the fact of the matter is that, you know, when we're addressing, you know, video games, it's not that I don't agree that judges think video games are less than books or film or television. Maybe they think it's less than newspapers, I don't know. But the thing is, video games are, in fact, different. The way they're used is different, and that's why there's a difference in the jurisprudence. That's why the outcomes are different in cases involving, you know, sports teams, because, you know, a playable version of a real person is a different thing than a narrative description of something that happened, and it has to be analyzed differently. It's not because of the technology per se, it's because it's being used in a different manner. And I, you know, that could be a whole panel all on its own.
Yeah, I think it could panel, and yes. I think, you know, you and Kelly will have to agree to disagree on this one.
Save that for another
I want to take us from the ridiculous, the Noriega case, to a really complicated close case that was just recently settled. And I'm going to show you a little movie that appeared on Fox before the Super Bowl 2 years ago. So, this ran before the Super Bowl during that interminable run-up to the Super Bowl that we all sit through every year at our parties. It's obviously a beautifully expressive piece of work, but it was also clearly designed to promote viewership of the game. It came after Muhammad Ali had passed, so it was intended as a tribute and an obituary. I think we can all agree that if this had been on SportsCenter, and you know, at a different time, that it would be a different kind of case. But the Muhammad Ali Enterprises, the people who have his rights or the rights of his estate, brought a lawsuit against Fox, claiming a violation of its right of publicity. And I'm curious about the panel members' reaction to this, because this case just settled 2 weeks ago. Kelly's firm was involved in defending the case for Fox, so she may be a little constrained in speaking about it. But I think this is exactly what you were talking about before, Duncan, where expressive content and commercial are coming together, and it's difficult to figure out how will the right of publicity apply, because this is the kind of content that is coming and is getting more and more sophisticated and better all the time.
Anybody I mean, I am a little constrained about talking about this case because one of my partners from New York handled it. I wasn't involved in the case. I wasn't involved in the settlement. I didn't even know it had settled until Dale told me he had read about it in a news publication. So I had no involvement in it, but it also comes probably as no surprise to this audience that I think this is clearly content. And if it had been on a different network broadcast at exactly the same time period, the run-up to the Super Bowl, but not on the network that was actually airing the Super Bowl, I don't think there would have been a lawsuit, and nor do I think there should be a lawsuit just because it aired on Fox. This is not an advertisement for a commercial product. But nonetheless, there was a lawsuit because the law is in somewhat of a muddle.
Well, I guess I would say, you know, I agree with like 85% of what Kelly just said.
15% just can't get there.
Which is, I agree that if it had been on a different network, there wouldn't have been a lawsuit, nor should there have been a lawsuit if it had been on a different network. I guess the question that I think it raises is, you know, when something is put together, I mean, if this had started out with the Nike logo, had ended with the Nike logo, and had been exactly the same as it was otherwise, right? I think people would generally say, okay, that was a beautifully created Nike commercial, right? That's basically what it was. The fact that it's promoting something that, a product that happens to also be, you know, an intangible, instead of it being Nike footwear, it's a, you know, a sporting event that's gonna be broadcast on television, I don't see why that should change that analysis. So to my mind, I think, you know, I mean, I don't know all the facts of it. Unlike Kelly, my organization was not involved in this whatsoever. So I don't know any facts other than what we've seen here. But the idea that that would be viewed as a commercial for the broadcast of the Super Bowl does not shock me.
Ben, thoughts?
Sure. I should also give my little disclaimer. Fox is a member of the Motion Picture Association. We had nothing to do with this particular lawsuit. It's very interesting to me, you know, talking about you know, the variety of different tests applied across the country. One of these being in Missouri, like the predominant purpose test, is your predominant purpose to sort of derive the money from the economic value of the celebrity. If you apply that test, even in a pure documentary sense, if Fox had just said we're going to do a documentary about Muhammad Ali. And they showed a lot of the same footage and made a lot of the same, had a lot of the same themes about his being the greatest and having courage to stand up against the federal government that was trying to send him to Vietnam. There's a lot of people who would have watched that solely because of his persona. Just because it ran, you know, instead of, you know, 8 o'clock on a Tuesday night versus on ESPN, versus, you know, 7 o'clock on a Sunday evening right before the Super Bowl, should not really, to me, make a difference. And just, again, when you think about the scope of some of these tests and the way, and the fuzziness of them, it shows that anything like this is subject to a claim. And again, this has a chilling effect, and, you know, Fox settled it. I'm sure they had to pay, write a nice check. That is gonna make them think two or three times very hard about the next time they want to do something like this, even though I think it does have, as I think everyone on the stage would say, a lot of value from a historical perspective, and certainly the audience would benefit from seeing it.
And it's beautifully done. Yeah. I mean, it's obviously extremely creative, expressive activity. Before we run out of time, are there questions? Because otherwise I have one last question I'd like to ask the panel. But yeah. You sure? Okay. So, what should the standard be? What should be the test?
Well, for me, it's easy. I think that the correct test was the test applied by the Ninth Circuit in the Sarver case. It is an infringement on speech. It is a content-based restriction if it involves an expressive work. We're not talking about Nike shoes or advertisements for products. We're talking about expressive works. I think the test is strict scrutiny, and the constitutional requirement is compelling interest, and it has to be narrowly tailored. And that's the standard I think should be applied. And had that been argued in some of these other cases, maybe the results would have been different. But that's, I think, the correct constitutional test. And then you just see whether that test has been satisfied, like in a Zucchini case or not.
Yeah, I agree with everything that Kelly just said, but let me just add one thing into addressing that Duncan mentioned earlier. You made several comparisons or analogies between right-of-publicity law and copyright law, which is fairly said, I think, a hybrid of both privacy and property law. But I reject this analogy to copyright law. Copyright law, which obviously the Motion Picture Association is a strong supporter of strong copyright law, but one thing that's clear in copyright law, and something that we don't dispute, is that it doesn't cover facts. You can't copyright facts. No one has a monopoly on the use of facts. That is exactly what the Ninth Circuit said in the Sarver case. There's this great passage at the end of the opinion which says that filmmakers and authors and journalists have the right to draw from the, quote, raw material of life tell their stories. This goes back to Shakespeare and probably well before. I think in our materials you have the amicus brief that Kelly wrote for us in the Sarver case, and there's a whole great section sort of telling the history and how important it is from to journalists and storytellers and playwrights, et cetera, for many centuries, to be able to draw facts from the raw material of life, as the Ninth Circuit put it, to tell stories. And hopefully someday we'll have resolution of these issues to take away the abundance of caution or the chilling effect that Bly talked about.
Bly, what would you like to come out of all of this?
Just make it simple and uniform. Simple and uniform, so everybody knows under the rules in which they have to operate.
And Duncan, last word.
Well, I think we can move in the direction of more simple and more uniform. I think just like copyright and other intellectual property rights, it'll probably be a long time before it's ever simple or completely uniform. Having said that, you know, I think that that the reality is probably a combination of the existing tests that are out there that I think we're moving in the direction of. I think it's going to be partially transformative, notwithstanding the dislike for that expressed by some of my friends here on the panel. Probably with some, a public affairs, public interest piece. And I think, you know, it remains to be seen how much of that is developed judicially and how much of that is developed through legislative activity, because this is not only active on the judicial front, which is what we've been focused on. We ran out of time to talk about the legislative front, but I mean, this is a very active area legislatively as well. And so I think it's gonna take some time, but I do think those two paths will tend to move us in the direction of a single, more easily understood and applied standard over time.
Okay. Well, thank you all. I hope you'll join me in thanking this terrific panel.